अदरवाइज जनरल इंफॉर्मेशन यू कैन डेफिनेटली यूज फॉर द साइज, शुड बी मूव फॉरवर्ड देन. Fine. So let's come to, let's discuss your, let's start with let's start with your Mesolithic culture. There is a difference between two terms. If I use the term Mesolithic culture and if I use the term Mesolithic age. In archaeology, these two terms are different. Mesolithic age refers to the period which is not dominated by the Mesolithic tools, but we find the Mesolithic tool. Mesolithic tool means microlith. I'll come to it. Just wait for a few minutes. So Mesolithic tools means microliths. So we find microliths in some other culture, in the layer of some other culture. Say, for example, in the upper Paleolithic layer of the site of Patne, in the upper Paleolithic layer, we find large number of microliths. This is what I have informed you just now in the previous slide, in the previous section of Paleolithic site. So what does this show? That Patne was also a site of Mesolithic age. So if you get a hint that a site of Mesolithic age, so you can easily mark it down. It is Patne. Got it? So this information can be used because in hint, these terms are given and sometimes people get confused. What does these terms specifically mean? And UPSC will utilize that kind of confusion to create the difference between difference among the aspirants. That is what we will try to focus on. And this Mesolithic age, so if you get for Patne, you can get this hint also. Mesolithic age. A Mesolithic culture is, of course, the period where we have the dominant features of Mesolithic period, means the dominant tool found was your microliths. Dominant tool was your microliths. Fine. So what is this microlith? Till now, in this Paleolithic age, we have discussed your stone tools, the type of stone tools like your core tools, your flake tools, and in the upper Paleolithic level, we found your blades and your burines, blade and burines. These tools are relatively of larger size, means they are of bigger size. Core tools means lower Paleolithic level, the biggest tools were used. Then middle Paleolithic level, relatively bigger tool. Then upper Paleolithic level, kind of the tool size decreases, but in comparison to the Mesolithic, it is still bigger. So when we come to this Mesolithic period, the mankind have evolved somewhat. So they started making very small tools, and those tools are called microliths. So the characteristic of microliths is they are very small in size. And if you want to write any example, the names of microliths, the microliths is again a generic name which you can use in your answer. More specific, in the advanced microliths, the advanced phase of microlith industry, we found this geometric microlith. So you can use this term when geometric microliths like triangles, like trapezes. So these are examples of microliths you can utilize in your answer, in your description. Geometric microliths like triangles and trapezes. Got it? So this was one particular thing about tool. That tool was microlith. What about tool material? Again, with advancement, the diversification of tool material comes. So the same thing is witnessed during this period also. With advancement, we are not using only quartz. We are not using only quartz or some only stone tools. Only stone tools. Apart from quartz, in a stone tool, we find a large number of tools made of chert. We also find a large number of tools made of chalcedony. So this chert, quartz, and chalcedony, these are the prime materials which are being used to make tools. Apart from these stones, we also use the bone and your horn to make tools. Please remember, you can relate, in the upper Paleolithic level, we also found bone and horn tools. Same practice actually got more substantive, more advanced during this Mesolithic period, and we find a large number of bone and horn tools in this period. So we have seen stone to means tool type, that is microlith. The example your geometric microliths of triangles and trapezes. We have seen the material, quartz, chert, chalcedony, and bone and horn tools. While discussing the specific site, I will focus on which site we get bone tools or which site we don't. Now moving to the next general feature. The first feature was your tool, and the second one, let's see. The second one is in this phase, what is the subsistence level? How people got their food? Subsistence actually denotes that aspect also, the activity which helps us to earn food for living. So in Paleolithic, we know that it was your hunting and gathering. In Mesolithic, what happens, apart from this hunting gathering continued, but apart from this hunting gathering, in few sites we also found the remains or the traces of domestication of animal. So it is again a thing which you should notice, from which sites we found this domestication or remains of domestication of animal, that you should remember. Then moving forward, the next site with the domestication means a kind of sedentary lifestyle is coming. It's not completely sedentary yet, but they are not as nomadic as they were in your Paleolithic age. Some kind of semi-nomadic lifestyle is started in this period, and therefore with semi-nomadic lifestyle there come some changes or some development on the cultural aspects. Say, for example, we also get the remains of, or the findings shows the remains of start of burial system. We find human burials for the first time during this Mesolithic culture. We also find the remains of pottery. The potsherds have been found, means broken pottery material have been found from some sites. So those findings need to be specified. So what are the important things which are, or changes which are occurring in this period? One, it was a change in the tool type and the tool material. The second one is in the subsistence pattern, means apart from hunting gathering, the start of domestication of animal is taking place. One more thing in subsistence you can write down, the people of Mesolithic age or Mesolithic culture, they are actually utilizing, or they are using, or they are consuming the naturally, or you can say the wild variety of seeds and some crop materials which are of wide variety. The people of Mesolithic period, they are actually consuming it. From few centers we get the direct evidence of that, and from few other centers there are no direct evidence, but there is indirect evidence of food processing of these wild variety of seeds, wild varieties. And what is that evidence, or which tools were used for this food processing? You can write down the name, that is your Quern and Mueller. So these were the tools which were used to process the food. In your northern part of India, we use the term in Hindi, we call it musal, na? In villages itself, in today's villages also, we find these kind of tools to process or to actually process the raw crop and use it for consumption and make it ready for consumption. So those evidences started appearing from Mesolithic level, which signifies or which tells us that some kind of food processing thing was happening, some kind of, because the food production hasn't started. Therefore, the processing of what was done, the processing of your wild varieties of seeds were done. So those informations are important with respect to a subsistence level. Burial system and pottery, we will see from which site we get which information, which specific information. So I think this will help you in knowing the or generalizing things about Mesolithic culture. Now moving to this Mesolithic sites. Which are the problem? We will see it state wise. It will help you in better retention. So let's start with in northwestern part. Especially in the Pakistan region, no Mesolithic culture is found. In the state of or the UT of Ladakh and J&K, we don't have any Mesolithic site. From Himachal, Punjab, Haryana, Delhi, Uttarakhand, no. Means the whole of North India is devoid of any important Mesolithic site. But when we come to the state of Rajasthan, you come to see the most important, one of the most important Mesolithic site, and the name of that site is Baghor. Please remember this, Baghor and Baghor, they are two different things. This is Baghor and this is Baghor. So these names, please don't get confused. One is located in the state of MP, whereas the other one is in the state of Rajasthan. Got it? So in locational aspects, again, you won't have any issue because it is a kind of lone site, solo site in the state of Rajasthan. And you can easily identify it if you remember the state and the state. What are the important information, any specific information about this site? So please see to it. Yes, there are few important informations regarding to your site of Baghor. The first and the foremost is here itself. It's written that it is the largest Mesolithic site. And for these Mesolithic and the coming Neolithic also, we will try to remember the ages of the site, the period of that site, because we do not have unified period in different regions of your Indian subcontinent for any specific culture. Neolithic culture emerged in northwestern part very early, whereas it emerged in your northeastern part and your eastern India relatively later, after 2000 BC. So you need to remember broad, you can say, the period of that specific site, and you can easily, your, it will distinguish, it will add value to your description if you can remember it. So for Baghor, you can write down it has three cultures, starting from your Mesolithic, then your Chalcolithic, and then your Iron Age. Please remember, this site doesn't show the evidence of Neolithic. Neolithic. It happens. In few sites, we will find that there is no evidence of Mesolithic. Then in few sites, we'll find that there is no evidence of Neolithic. And there is direct from Mesolithic, we will jump to Chalcolithic, especially in the state of Rajasthan. Rajasthan, we have this kind of finding that there is no Neolithic site as such. We will jump from Mesolithic to Chalcolithic itself. Fine. So this state of Bagor, the first and the you can just write down three cultural phases, and after your dash you can write Mesolithic, Chalcolithic and your Iron Age. Then in next point you can mention Neolithic age. It's 5000 to 2800 BCE, 5000 to 2800 BCE. Then specific information, largest Mesolithic site in India. Next, you can mention this age is given. It's given in the notes. You can remember. Then the general tools, you can easily mention that the geometric microliths, which we have discussed, that you can mention. Chert and quartz, I have already discussed that you can mention. One important point with respect to the tool material is that chalcedony tools have been found. And chalcedony as such is not found in this region of Rajasthan. It is found in your nearby region of Deccan, means your region of North Maharashtra and the nearby Gujarat. So it shows that there was some kind of communication between people of this culture or the people of Bagor with this the people living in this northern Deccan region. So that is an important thing which you can highlight. And subsistence, we have already mentioned hunter-gatherer mainly, but domestication, this point is important. You can mention that remains of domesticated animals, sheep, goat and your cattle has been found. So this domestication of animal has started from, or remains have been found from the site of Bagor. Then settlements is fine. Burial, we haven't found any specific information about the burial. One burial we have found, but there was no grave good as such. So there is no specific additional information to write. Fine. Other site from the same state of Rajasthan is Tilwara. It has general findings you can write. A special one is definitely this domestication, remains of domesticated humped bulls, humped cattle remains has been found. This is a special point which you can mention. The most important site was Bagor. Therefore, we discussed it elaborately. You can get this site. The hint itself can be the largest Mesolithic site or Mesolithic site in which you can use this specific information that it is the largest Mesolithic site in India. Now moving to the state of Gujarat. From the state of Gujarat, we have two very prominent sites. Actually, we have three sites. The site of Langanaj and Loteshwar. Very near to Loteshwar, you have one more site of Ratanpura. But since it's very near to Loteshwar, so we do not we can just write one name. So that will suffice. So Loteshwar, it's fine. Langanaj and Loteshwar, you need to, I believe you can easily locate these sites. To remember it, just try to divide this or just try to see this line. The east, this Langanaj lies in the eastern part of this line, means it's not like you need to draw anything. You just need to think, or you just need to feed this information in your mind, and which will help you in during the time of revision. And otherwise, these sites are far away, so you can easily identify if you revise it properly. State in Gujarat, the two prominent sites, Langanaj and Loteshwar. What are the important things about Langanaj? Please note it down. There are few things which are specific for Langanaj. General aspect, definitely you can mention. I don't need to discuss it again. But while discussing the general aspect, I told you that from few sites, we found this pottery. From few sites, we found this pottery, and Langnaj is one of the sites where the remains of pot sheets have been found in this Mesolithic level. Mesolithic level, so remains of pot shade means broken ceramic material have been found. So this point is prominent that the remains of pottery has been found in Mesolithic level. Then moving forward in Langnaj, tools, you can general, these are the very general two things which you can write. Human burials have been found. This is again an important aspect, because burials are not found from Mesolithic in each and every site. Therefore, it holds importance. Langnaj. Domestication. There is no specific information about domestication, so we will avoid that point. But we can definitely use these two points, these two specific points for Langnaj to write a better description, a better answer. Got it? And the next point is Lotheshwar. Although Langnaj is very prominent, more prominent than Lotheshwar, but please see to it. From Lotheshwar also, we have a few findings which you can mention. The first and this pot shade thing you can mention, it is also fine, and this human burial thing, it's very similar kind of finding from Lotheshwar also. So this north and northwest part of India, we are done. In the state of Rajasthan, the state of Gujarat. Now moving eastward, we come to the state of MP, Madhya Pradesh. In Madhya Pradesh, we have two prominent sites again, which were actually we discussed in your Paleolithic period also, the site of Adamgarh and Bhimbetka. How to differentiate or how to locate it properly, that we have discussed. That need not be repeated over here. Just see few specific information regarding these sites. From your Bhimbetka, let's see Bhimbetka, because Bhimbetka is a most prominent rock painting site, means prehistoric rock painting site in the whole of Indian subcontinent. If you ask to name, if you are asked to name the most important site, it will be Bhimbetka. So if you get a hint of prehistoric rock painting site, so most probably it will be Bhimbetka only, but please draw that line to know the exact site, because prehistoric paintings are also found from Adamgarh. Coming back to this Bhimbetka, what are the specific information which you can write? Specific information. So yesterday I have already told you, from this Mesolithic level, these paintings, what does they tell us? They tell us about the subsistence pattern. They tells us about the societal pattern, means that man society aspect. They also tells us about the leisure activities, that is this dancing and all those things, the group dancing activities. They are seen from these paintings, the prehistoric paintings of Bhimbetka. Apart from this, this aspect also I have discussed, because this is from Paleolithic level, that ostrich egg beads were found. So means some kind of shell ornamentation or bone ornamentation has already started from your Paleolithic level. Then one aspect of is very important for your Bhimbetka is that it shows some rocks with cup marks, a specific kind of marks on rocks. The scholars have identified it as some kind of cultic significance. These rocks have some kind of cultic significance. So again, this shows or this signifies a start of religious belief system or a cult kind of things in your prehistoric man. So that information is again important with respect to Bhimbetka. And of course, Bhimbetka is a your World Heritage Site, UNESCO World Heritage Site, that you can mention. So with respect to Bhimbetka, you can get the hint of either Paleolithic, you can get the hint of Mesolithic, or most probably you can get the hint of your prehistoric site, or say prehistoric rock painting site. So these kind of different hints can be given for the same site of Bhimbetka. So please do remember that all the hints are signifying or directing us to the same site of Bhimbetka. Moving to the next site in the state of MP, Again, Bagore, we have discussed from this site of Bagore. We have already located it from the site of Bagore. We also have upper Paleolithic level, from where we got few the finding of that goddess shrine that we have discussed. From your Mesolithic level, you can write general aspect like the microliths were found and the people they have started this food processing. This Quants and Muller shows this kind of food processing industry has started. So those kind of information. These are generic which you can write for Bagore with respect to Mesolithic also. Then coming back to your other sites. Let's see. In the state of UP, you have few prominent sites, actually very prominent site, Mesolithic site. So what are these sites? Chupani Mando, we have already discussed. And again, please do that work, which I've already told you that you need to connect this point with respect to this point. It will demarcate or easily it is actually dividing line between your MP and UP. So from the sites like Baghor, in future we will see other sites also. So you won't be confused between this UP and MP sites if the political map is not given. Got it? Moving forward. So from the site of UP, Chupani Mando, we have discussed the sites which are more prominent, or you can say most prominent, are the three sites which are located very near to each other. And what are the name of these sites? These sites are your Sarayanaharai, you have Mahadaha and Damdama. These three sites. So how you can locate it, so it's very tough to demarcate these sites. So you can try, but it the better way will be to write the name of one, and in bracket you can use the name of others. You can write the name of others. And this Sarayanaharai is a most prominent site from this these three. But please see to it how north or south this line, from this line you can see the distance. If it is relatively closer to this Nepal border, then it must be Damdama or Mahadaha rather than Sarayanaharai. So that kind of generic locational technique you can utilize. Otherwise, you write down one site and in bracket write down the name of others. Now see the description, and description is important with respect to your this site of Sarayanaharai as well as Mahada. So what are the things which are specifics with respect to your Sarayanaharai? What are the things which are specific? So first thing, you can write down the age, because again, I have told you that different regions have, or different sites have different ages. So for important sites, you can mention the ages. And of course, you can write down this human burial thing, because we found the grave goods and number of human burials have been found from this region. What does we know about the subsistence pattern? The subsistence pattern, since there are Quants and Mullers, so it suggests that there is processing from this site of Sarayanaharai. Apart from this bone tool and ornament is an important thing, which is specifically which we found in these three sites, means in the site of Sarayanaharai, Mahadaha and Damdama. All three we have these kind of information: Sarayanaharai, Mahadaha and Damdama. So these are the important things, means burial and the grave good information if you have, then bone tools we have discussed in while discussing the common features. Also I have highlighted this because there is a diversification of material used for tools, and in this diversification the men did not stick to stones only. They have started using bones and horns of the animals for making tools. So those evidences have been found from the site of Sarai Nahar Rai as well as Mahadaha. Got it? Then again, these informations are relatively same for Mahadaha and Sarai Nahar Rai. For Damdama, one thing holds importance, and that is in the recent finding of domesticated rice have been found from the layer of Mesolithic from this region. Got it? And the age is definitely your 7000 BC. For this whole rice cultivation thing, we will discuss it more comprehensively while seeing discussing your Neolithic phase, because from Neolithic age we find few sites where we have independent origin of rice in India, because actually all over the world it is believed that domesticated rice was first cultivated in China, and from that region it actually got transmitted to other regions of your subcontinent or your world. But recent findings or the research by the scholars shows that in India also a site with the name of Lahura Deva, from there we found the evidence of independent domestication of this rice, and that belongs to some age around maybe around 9th in your 9th millennium BC, 9th millennium BC. So while discussing this Lahura Deva, I'll again discuss that thing. But this was a specific information which makes the site of Lahura Deva very prominent. It's actually a Neolithic site. We'll come to it. So I hope this completes. For Chopani Mando, please note down this wild rice aspect. Wild rice from Mesolithic level, we have found this wild rice. And again, from this, we have found the evidence of use of pottery. Few scholars have argued that the earliest evidence of use of pottery in India comes from this region of Chopani Mando. This is a very specific point, because this information you can easily utilize in your description. So Chopani Mando, Sarai Nahar Rai, Mahadaha, Damdama, and Lekhakia. Lekhakia is a other site from your UP. It is located, if you see the location, it's relatively nearer to that line which divides your state of UP and MP. So it is very near to Chopani Mando. Got it. So this completes one section of your Mesolithic site. Please remember, for Mesolithic sites, we do not found any Mesolithic site in the Deccan region except the extreme south. In extreme south, we have two prominent Mesolithic sites that we will discuss in our next slide. But in Deccan region, no prominent Mesolithic site. In your northwestern part of Indian subcontinent, we didn't find any evidence of new Mesolithic site. The same holds true for your northeastern part of your Indian subcontinent. We didn't found any major Mesolithic site from that region also. Now let's see the remaining sites, Mesolithic sites of your India. Again, in the state of Uttar Pradesh, till Uttar Pradesh we have seen. Moving eastward, we come to the state of Bihar. You have a Mesolithic site of Paisara. It was a Paleolithic site also. It is a Mesolithic site also. General informations you can write. Then The state of West Bengal, yes, state of West Bengal has a prominent Mesolithic site with the name of Birbhanpur. Birbhanpur, this location is actually a little bit north. So you can get either this or some books have shown it over here also. So you can get this location also. So Mesolithic site, a prominent Mesolithic site in the state of West Bengal is Birbhanpur. So if you get any site nearby it, it is Birbhanpur only, because UPSC do not actually mark the exact location. So you need to utilize your knowledge. You need to utilize the general understanding to locate it correctly. So this information you can use Birbhanpur. Then in the state of, and it is not tough to locate. If this political map is not given, then also it is not tough, because it will lie above, means you can say northwestern region of Calcutta. If you see this is Calcutta, then northwestern region of Calcutta. There is no other site, no other prominent site in this region. So you can mark Birbhanpur. When moving southward, when you come to the state of Odisha, you have a good prominent site of Kutchai. Kutchai has been asked in your previous year papers. It is a prominent Neolithic site also, and it is an important Mesolithic site also. The two cultures you can mention, and the general informations you can write. For identification, if this state border is not given, so please don't get confused between Birbhanpur and Kutchai, because if you see this bulge in the outline map of Odisha, na, so the nearby region, the nearby site is your or you can say the northeast, northwestern section or northwest located to this bulge is your site of Kutchai, whereas Birbhanpur is northwest of this Calcutta. It is in the northern region, not in the western section as such. So Birbhanpur, Kutchai, location done. Informations you can write generally. The whole of Deccan region is actually, we do not find any Mesolithic site. So no prominent site, no issues, fine. It's good for us. So we need to remember lesser sites. UPSC won't give us names, so it's fine. Now see, in the state of, or the southern section, means the southernmost portion of your India, we find two sites, Terisites and Tenmalai. Tenmalai is in Kerala, whereas Terisites is in your Tamil Nadu. It is actually located on the sand dune site. And so this geographical information you can write for Kutchai. And apart from that, for Terisite, you can write that it is again an important site, because it was discovered by Sir Robert Bruce Fouté, means again the father of our archaeology, Robert Bruce Fouté. So again this site becomes important because it was discovered by him, and he was in news because of this naming of that specific Sangan Kallu, this place, or which was started in your 2020. So Terisites, Tenmalai, general informations you can write. For Terisites, the specific point was it was actually located on a sand dune site. Then hope this completes your Mesolithic. We have elaborately discussed it from the locational aspect also, and from your descriptional aspect also. So if you have any doubt in Mesolithic, you can ask it. Or should we move to Neolithic period? It's fine with everyone, means we should move forward, na? Okay. So now we can start with the next period, which is again among this whole Stone Age, this is the most important period with respect to examination, because you got a large number of sites, relatively large number of sites from this period. So starting with the general features, Neolithic Age, Neolithic culture. Neolithic culture sites. What are the general features of Neolithic Age? Of course, everyone will argue that it is the start of agriculture, or this agricultural revolution. But there are other specific informations about Neolithic site which you need to remember, which can be helpful in general basis also in solving the your question, the essay type question, and definitely it will be helpful in this map section. So what are these general aspects? Let's see. First, of course, tool. Tool. What changed during this Neolithic period? The change was visible in this tool manufacturing technique. I have already told you yesterday that during Paleolithic period and even in Mesolithic, the technique was same kind of that the Paleolithic and Mesolithic men, they broke one stone with the help of some other heavy material and thus they made the tool. They didn't use any polishing technique, or you can say any rubbing technique or any grinding technique to make the tool. So they are kind of core and flakes which were formed by creating or breaking the stones. But during this Neolithic period, what happens that a different technique of tool manufacturing emerges, and the people started using the method of grinding or rubbing stones. And because of this technique, you will find that the tools are becoming polished. If you grind something, it will become smooth. So therefore, the Neolithic tools will be polished tool. You must have read this term several times, but you will remember it from now, because you know the reason, you know this specific characteristic. So polished tool. And these tools, you can say, they can be celts, they can be edges, they can be even axes, stone axes. The polished stone axes were there, polished shouldered celts were there, polished normal celts were there, polished edges were there. So you get these examples, the name of these tools which you can utilize in your description. Now, tool material, diversification. With evolution, this diversification increases. So we find more diversified material for stone tools, as well as we find more bone and horn tools. When we see this Neolithic culture of your region of your Ganga Plains, and also the region of Kashmir Neolithic, we will find that they were using these bone tools. So it is a characteristic feature, right? So this tool and tool material, there was some change we noticed. Now moving to the next part, that is your subsistence. Of course, this was the major thing, because this whole Neolithic is called revolutionary because of the start of agriculture. So plant cultivation means agriculture started, plus domestication of animal was again practiced, or it was the degree increased with time. Then one more thing, it doesn't mean that all these people who just entered the Neolithic age, they left this hunting and gathering thing. it continued for some time. In few cultures like Kashmir Neolithic, we will see that it only this whole farming thing gained ground in only by after say 100 or say 1000 years of your start of Neolithic, 1000 years after start of Neolithic phase. So this hunting gathering did continue in some specific regions for some specific people.